The Kade Family Saga, Volume 2, A Place of Promise. Written by Laurel Mouritsen. Narrated by Nancy Peterson. Chapter 1. It was cold. So bitterly cold that Elizabeth's breath frosted the window as she stared out into the night. The angry shouts coming from the street terrified her, and the light blazing from a dozen torches scorched her eyes. In the gleam of the bobbing and weaving torches, she saw dark shadows darting across the yard. "They're coming, Mama," she cried. She turned from the window just as the door to the cabin burst open with a sharp crack, and cold air rushed in. On its wing came half a dozen men with torches flaring. The intruders overturned furniture, smashed crystal and china, jerked draperies from windows. Rough hands grabbed at her. Elizabeth tried to dodge away, but her body moved like a clock winding down. She screamed as one of the men cornered her, his eyes wild and brutal. She twisted out of his reach, screaming, screaming, screaming. Elizabeth awoke with a start. Sweat was pouring down her cheeks, and her legs were tangled in the bedclothes. The close darkness in the room felt suffocating. She gasped for breath, desperate to dispel the darkness and the ghostly nightmares. She scrambled from her bed and, with shaking hands, lighted the oil lamp on the nightstand, then turned up the flame until it drove the midnight shadows into the corners of the room. She cast a hasty glance at the window near her bed, afraid of seeing gleaming torches outside. She hadn't experienced a nightmare like this one in over a year. She used to have them often, waking in the middle of the night with a scream on her lips and her nightgown soaking with perspiration. The Missouri persecutions still scarred her memories. But there were no torches now, no mob, and no angry shouts coming from the street. The only sound was her sister's quiet breathing as they slept. Elizabeth drew a shaky breath and turned down the lamp before its glowing light woke her sisters. She felt calmer now. She gathered enough courage to walk to the window and look out. A half moon rode high in the sky, shedding a soft light onto the fields and gardens below. All seemed silent, still, and serene. Elizabeth pressed her nose against the pane. From her spot in the loft room, she could see half a dozen cabins nestled along the bend of the river, cozily wrapped in darkness. No demons rode abroad on the streets. No ghosts floated among the fields. The only specters lingering now existed solely in her mind, haunting her with fearful memories. She wondered if James was ever tortured by such nightmares. Perhaps he had been too young to have many memories of their sufferings in Jackson County. Her brother had been only 3 years old when their father died and their mother sold the family farm and moved with Elizabeth and James to Missouri. In those days, the three of them had clung to each other for safety and support. But then her mother had met Christian Kade, and before Elizabeth could come to terms with the idea of having a stepfather disrupt the balance of their family circle, her mother had married him. She and James called him father, but the name had never tasted sweet in Elizabeth's mouth. For Elizabeth, having Christian take the place of her natural father was another in a string of adversities she had suffered in Missouri. She cast a last quick glance out the window and then padded back to her bed. She lay under the blanket of moonlight, trying to dispel from her mind the last blurry remnants of her nightmare. Chapter 2.
That's it. Secure the bandage now. Don't tie it too tightly.
Dr. John C. Bennett stood back, allowing his young protege to complete the dressing. James Kade fumbled with the cloth bandage, and it was some seconds before the unruly ends yielded to his inexperienced fingers. Dr. Bennett peered at the dressing James had just applied and then addressed his patient.
"That should take care of it, Brother Carter. Keep your arm immobile for the next few weeks and it should heal nicely." "Thanks, Dr. Bennett. I appreciate it."
Phineas Carter shook Bennett's hand, tipped his hat at James, and then left the office. The doctor began putting away the unused gauze and instruments.
"That was a nasty gash, wasn't it, Dr. Bennett?"
James said, wincing as he recalled the ragged tear in Carter's forearm.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.